I'm very often to China because we're neighbors, and I wanted to listen, to learn more, and as well as to tell my story, my advice. Most of the time I'm in Beijing. But this year I was privileged to go to two poorer provinces in China, in Gansu province, in Tibet Autonomous Region, and Inner Mongolia. In Gansu province, we drove 300 kilometers from Lanzhou to the Tibet, this very expensive highway. Dozens and dozens of tunnels, very expensive road, brought us to the region where only 700,000 people live. So I immediately asked, it cannot be justified economically. Why China investing so much money to very remote part of the country when there is no economic activity? And the answer was that we want to help people which live there, that they will have better access to other part of the country. This is great characteristic of socialism, when central government getting resources from rich province, bringing them to poorer province. In Inner Mongolia, there is a famous Kubuchi desertification project for many years. They fight something like a territory similar to Israel, huge territory. And I was surprised, amazed that this project, which is around 40 billion renminbi, was invested by private company. From their own revenues from other business, they decided to bring it to the desert to help two people who live there. 120,000 people getting jobs, get out of poverty. This is another unique characteristic, when a successful private companies helping to the population, to society. So this is most impressive facts for me. Not skyscrapers of Shenzhen or Guangzhou or Shanghai, but what happening in rural areas, in remote parts of China, in landlocked provinces. This is absolutely new story for me. People to people, culture to culture, tradition to tradition, to understand how different people, different countries are behaving. So you need to know more people in other places in the world, and other people should know more about China. This is only beginning of this opening up process of understanding people. Not only numbers, not only economic growth, inflation, external trade, whatever. It's understanding humans, beings, understanding differences, and understanding how to get closer to each other. So world will be smaller when it will be trust. So the name of the game is trust, building trust. This is the most important element of the future world. That people will not be suspicious about each other's behavior. It should be very honest, friendly behavior and relationships. 6 years ago, President Xi Jinping made this announcement in Central Asia, in my region. So we were very enthusiastic during that time because we are quite emotional about old Silk Road. Remember when Central Asia was bridged between Europe and China in Middle Ages. So we were really very enthusiastic when things developed. Now more and more countries want to join. 100 plus countries, almost around the world, only few left without joining this initiative. Why? Because good, great characteristic of this initiative is not insistence, it's grand invitation. You want to work with us on that fair kind of principles? Yes, okay, let's join, let's make this world more harmonious place. So, from so-called New Silk Road concept, is developed as a global initiative. But we are in Central Asia, still believe that Central Asia will be the testing ground for Belt and Road success. So we want to be in the front of the development between our region, our countries, and China. We were neighbors all centuries around us, always. So we were good friends. So now we have to develop our relationships in the 21st century of global connectivity and global technological revolution, when things as never before were so interconnected.